worship and sing today. And so I'm glad that everybody's here. As we, the second Sunday in July. 7 months into the year already.
Yep.
Means just over the horizon is New Year's Eve. I'm skipping anything that is in the heat and looking forward to the coldness. And then, of course, when it gets cold, we'll be complaining, wishing it was warm again. Welcome to Texas. But what are we celebrating this week?
Just how good God is in a tense situation.
How good God is in a tense situation, definitely. That he was with y'all in your accident,
yes.
Kept y'all safe, and
yes.
Y'all didn't have to go to the hospital with anything broken or damaged. Airbags and seatbelts do work wonders. So
yes, thank you.
Glad for that. Anything else that we're celebrating this week? Losing some is always better than gaining a lot.
That is true.
All right.
Okay.
All right. Well, why don't you come up and lead us in a good old occult song. That when Landon was just a
wee little
grasshopper.
Wee little grasshopper.
Praise
get you going. I don't know what's going to get us going this morning. Did y'all keep up with it?
Perfect.
I didn't perfect harmony, but I don't know if I did or not. But let's talk about no more, longer slaves. Because when God gets you, slaves.
I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God. You unravel me with melody. You surround me with song of deliverance from my enemies until all my fears are gone. And I'm no longer a slave to fear. Oh, I am a child of God.
And I am surrounded
Dissension and separation in the workplace. Praying that God's presence and His Spirit will be present in those situations so that you never like going to place to work or place to do school or anything that is that you feel intimidated or anxious about. Because nobody functions well with that. I know several have some doctor's appointments coming up, and so we'll be praying for those as well. All right. God, we thank You that You hear us when we call. We thank You that You do not give us a spirit of fear. But Your Word tells us that You give us a sound mind and a faithful heart. We praise You that You hear and You answer our prayers. We've seen You do it time and time again. And where it seems like all hope was lost, You have split that sea wide open and we walked across on dry ground. We ask that You do that again in these situations. For the workplace situations, that You would be the peace that floods that place. That instead of the animosity and the division that's there, that all that is felt is Your presence, Your peace, and Your love. We ask for those that have doctor appointments this week, that You would be the doctors and the situations. We would ask that You be with those that are having the appointments, that You would give them a peace and that they would trust in You. For the unspoken requests that we have, we just ask that You meet that need. That's the wonderful thing about You, is that we don't have to voice it vocally. You already know what we need. You know that situation more than we ever could. So we just ask that You be in that moment for that individual. We thank You for those who You have placed and our care. That as the songs go out, the message goes out, that it's not us, it's not just this church that is proclaimed, it's you that is proclaimed. Because if it wasn't for you, we couldn't sing about having a new life and a new body one day. Or not having to worry or fear about anything. We just ask that you meet these needs in the only way that you can. We surrender them to you and we give them to you, knowing that you have it in your hands, which is a whole lot better control than we ever could. We ask these things in your precious and holy name. Amen. Come and lead us in one last song.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I stand, when everything around me is shaking. I've never been more glad. I put my faith in Jesus, 'cause He's never let me down.
that to the thing.
I like that because he won't fail us, and it ties in perfect with where we are today. In Ephesians, we're back in it, and we're not taking another break from Ephesians until we finish the book. We're in chapter 5, and we are rapidly running through the end of this. Next week will be a fun one as we start looking at how to do a home makeover, extreme God edition. And so next week we'll be co-leading as we'll be looking at what does the Bible say is the role of a husband, what the Bible says the role of the wife is. And then the following week we're going to dive into children, what is your role in the home? And however the home goes is how society goes. And so we'll end up looking at the end of chapter 5 as we look, in part of chapter 6, looking at how to deal with the environment in a workplace. And then we'll end out in the end of chapter 6 as we look at putting on the whole armor of God. We've said over and over again that if you want to get into a well-lived life for God, then there's a lot of things that you can do. And we looked at some of these, and that's where we're going with the rest of this book of Ephesians. But just like with anything else in life, if we want to know how to do something, we have to go to the owner's manual. You want to know how to change a light bulb in your stove. It's not just, if it's like our stove, it's not just as simple as reaching to the back, taking the light bulb out, and putting a new one. No, ours has a panel over it. So you have to go in and unscrew the panel, unscrew two latches, then you can unscrew the bulb and put everything back in there. Over on the 4th, putting together a barbecue grill. I read the manual. I looked at the manual. And the manual looked like the legs were supposed to be a certain way. But once you did that, and I did it the way that it looked like the manual was telling me to do, the wheels were in the front instead of in the back. And so I was like, well, we can just flip the wheels around. No, that didn't work either because it's not long enough, so you have to take the legs off and start all over again. Too many times in our life, we run into situations like that where we need a do-over. In golf, you have the luxury. You can take a mulligan. And in golf tournaments, you can actually pay for X number of mulligans. And you wipe out your score and you get to shoot again and it doesn't cost you a penalty stroke. Boy, wouldn't it be nice if life had mulligans. I messed up here. Well, let me start over. But unfortunately, life doesn't come with mulligans. But life does come with a blueprint of how to live life, how to do certain things, and one of those things is how to walk your everyday life. And so that's what we're going to look at today as we dive into this blueprint for life in Ephesians. And today I've got one simple question to start out with. How do we live a G-rated life and an R moving to X-rated world? How do we live a G-rated life in an R-rated world? We don't have to spend much time expounding all of the sick and depraved things that go on in our world. Unless you're an ostrich with your head buried in the sand, you know exactly what's going on. Pornography is a multi-billion dollar industry, destroying homes, families, marriages, children, everywhere you look. There's more porn outlets in the U.S. and strip clubs in the United States than there are McDonald's restaurants. And that's not including what's on the internet. That's just actual stores. When we're coming in from Slayton, I didn't look to see if the sign's still there. But just as we're coming into Slayton, there's a big billboard for a sex shop in town. They always got it out there for Christmas and everything else. We pass by it every time and we joke.
Is it when you're coming in? You're going to Slayton?
No, coming in from Slayton. And we pass by a strip club every time we go home. And we joke because most of the time there's only two or three cars there.
Yeah.
But it's funny, on Sunday mornings, there are about six or seven cars. The busiest that they ever are, Sunday morning. Before church.
Wow.
What are you talking about?
That
is their church.
Yeah, that's
there
right.
There church there.
Passed by yesterday to go pick my mom up for a women's retreat that she went to. And passed by on the loop, passed by Hooters. And they were setting up to put in, to do a car wash. Free ice cream for kids.
Haters.
Mm-hmm. Homosexuals are advancing their agenda in every corner of our country. To have elementary schools teach materials that tell young people that this lifestyle is okay.
Yeah.
I mean, they're... Who would have ever thought that we would come so far that we're having the conversation about passing laws that make it illegal to have drag queens read children's stories in libraries?
Yeah, that's okay.
And this is...
This is first graders.
Yeah, good grief, Charlie Brown. Where it is... there's a...
Is there any drag when they do?
New Jersey Board of Education is pushing an agenda to include mandatory book readings in elementary school of it's okay to be queer and white suppression and how it has destroyed America.
Oh my gosh.
And this is required reading for elementary.
They don't understand stuff like that.
Now, do you remember when everybody seemed to be outraged when Ellen came out of the closet on her TV show? And now, you can't see a commercial that doesn't push the agenda.
That's true.
Network
bad commercials and ours, great commercials.
Mm-hmm. Network television continues its downward spiral, hitting new lows. I remember my dad was so upset that I was required in one of my junior high classes to watch an episode of The Simpsons so that we could look at a dysfunctional family. And that was pretty raunchy and trashy. Simpsons is like watching Charlie Brown now compared to what we have out there. You have the Family Guy that it seems like every episode they have to have something in there attacking Jesus and making fun of him. Even churches are impacted by all sorts of sexual misconduct, with pastors and ministers having affairs, with sexual abuses. There was a 1,200-member church in Ohio whose pastor on a Sunday morning disclosed to his church that he was gay, was divorcing his wife for some 25 years, and they had three children together, but he needed to be happy. And the church's response? A standing ovation.
A standing ovation? So they kept him as the pastor?
They said, we were relieved. We thought he had cancer or some other life-threatening disease.
And
that's okay.
That was okay that it was gay.
And was left sin there.
Called sin.
Yes.
See, sin made them see about how R-rated and X-rated our society is.
Send them that picture on it. Call sin what it is.
Yeah. It's hard to live a G-rated life. A God-rated life. Now it's hard to find a G-rated movie.
Don't make them anymore.
Disney, you loved watching them, and anything the cleanest version they come out with is PG.
They don't do PG. They do PG-13.
Jerry Bridges, in his book The Pursuit of Holiness, states, in the Declaration of Independence, Thomas Jefferson declared that one of the inherent and unalienable rights of men is the pursuit of happiness. Professing Christians must be brought to realize that the preeminent desire and demand of God for us is that of the continual pursuit of holiness of life and the reflection of God's own holiness. Albert Edward Day said, we Protestants are an undiscipled people, undisciplined people. Therein lies the reason for much of the dearth of spiritual insights and serious lack of moral power. Basically saying, we'll go and chase anything and everything that comes our way. We're always looking for the next big deal, the next new high, the next thing to face. So where are those desires when it comes to something that is godly, something that is biblical, something that is wholesome, something that is set apart? Because that's what we are. Notice what Peter tells the readers. 1 Peter 1:15, but as he who called you is holy, you also must be holy in all your conduct. Holy means to be set apart. You are called for something better, something higher than what this world says. But what are we doing with that verse? Romans 6:14, Paul says, for sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. That's great. Sin's not our master anymore because we have grace, but what are we doing with that verse? The writer of Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14 says, strive for peace with everyone and for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. We're supposed to strive for peace, and if we don't have holiness, we can't see the Lord. But what are we doing with that verse? We kind of sang about it this morning. Romans 6:6. We know that our old self was crucified with Him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. We're no longer slaves. But what are we doing with that verse? Paul tells us again, Colossians chapter 3, verse 5. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you, sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desires, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Again, what are we doing with that verse? 1 Timothy 4:7. Have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. Rather, train yourself for godliness. But what are we doing with that verse? See, we need to look at the ways of the world. Look with me in Ephesians 3 and 4 of chapter 5. Ephesians 5, verses 3 and 4. But sexual immorality and all impurity or covetousness must not be even named among you, as is proper among saints. Let there be no filthiness, nor foolish talk, nor crude joking, which are out of place, but instead, let there be thanksgiving. See, we are in the world, but we're not to be of the world. But there's the ways of the world. Paul mentions some specific R-rated things. Sexual immorality comes from the word pornea, which refers to all sexual sins. And it says that we're supposed to, how does that say? It must not even be named among us. So we're not to have anything to do with a sexual sin. It's the opposite of enkratia, which refers to self-control, which is a fruit of the Spirit. Impurity comes from the word ekatharisia, a more general term referring to anything that is unclean and filthy. Jesus himself used this term when he talked about the bones inside of a tomb. When he told, in Matthew 23:27, told the Pharisees, you're like whitewashed tombs. You're nice and clean on the inside, but you're just full of dead man's bones. We're to be away from that. The other 10 times that it's used in the New Testament is associated with sexual sin. It refers to immoral thoughts, passions, ideas, fantasies, and any other type of sexual sin that we do, that we commit. So, what are we doing with that verse? With that part of the verse? Are we in the act of committing the sexual immorality and impurities? And then he mentions greed. We all know about greed. We're all greedy at times. It's usually associated with money, but we must realize that every form of sexual immorality is an expression of self-will. It's instant gratification. It's what we want. Any time that we are not doing any type of sexual activity outside of the bounds of marriage with anyone other than our spouse, we're being greedy. We are committing impurity, and we are committing sexual immorality. And here it says, if you're going to be walking for me and living for me, this can't even be mentioned about you. It can't even be named. You can't even be associated with it. Greed tells us that we must have more than we have right now, that we must do anything it takes to get more, including sacrificing our marriage, our kids, our careers, our friends. There's also obscenity and foolish talk or coarse jesting, which is still tied to Paul's discussion of sexual immorality. One of the Greek words used here is the form, the word that we get the English word moron. So as we use all of that talk and everything, we're telling sexual innuendos, we're watching that kind of stuff, all we're showing is our moronic behavior. That's why he told us in verse 1, notice what he says, therefore be imitators of God. Be imitators of God. If we're going to be imitators of God, is God doing any of these X-rated things? Or is he walking in love towards us? Remember, we're to live a life of love. Must not even be a hint of this in our lives. It's improper for God's holy people. Why? Because when we made a commitment to Christ, we made a commitment to live a holy, separated, called out life. That's why Romans chapter 10, verse 9 says that if we confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. It means that we agree to him, with him, that he's going to be our boss. That's why it says that Jesus is Lord, not that you just confess in Jesus. You're confessing that He is your Lord. So if He's your Lord, then that means you do what boss says. If you go to work and you do your own thing, what happens? Yeah, you don't have a job long. Because they'll tell you kind of like that old game show, The Weakest Link. You're the weakest link. Goodbye. See, He is our boss. Not our passions, not our desires, not our greed. They're out of place, according to what it says in verse 4. So, if that's the case, then what do? And is it really that bad? Well, let's see about a warning from God. Look at verse 5 through 7. Verse 5, he says, "For you may be sure of this, that everyone who is sexually immoral or impure, or who is covetous, that is, an idolater, has no inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not become partners with them." Don't partake with them. Growing up in Tornado Alley, we're used to tornado warnings. We have the TV, the radio that we can listen to. You get notifications on your phone. We now have sirens all over town. I remember growing up and going to school in the summertime, well, in the spring semesters, we'd always have tornado drills. You remember, go either hide under a desk or hide in the hallway and put your textbook over your neck, like that's really going to stop a beam from crushing you, but hey, at least you had your textbook in school. But the drills and sirens gave us an opportunity to be prepared for something that was coming. Never saw a tornado, never heard one close by. It wasn't until I was in my 30s before I ever saw a tornado, and it was still far away off that I wasn't in danger. But funny, the one time that I actually do see one close enough, there were no alarms that went off. I was looking around trying to find me a textbook. But these verses here that we just read, verses 5 through 7, are a tornado warning for us of what could happen if we practice what the world tells us is acceptable. Those who continually and habitually practice a sinful lifestyle will not be part of God's kingdom. So if we're constantly dabbling in sexual immorality, if we're constantly dabbling in greed and impurities, then we are saying that we are a better boss of our life than God. Don't know about you, but I don't think I want to be in that situation.
No, we need it.
They'll suffer His wrath. I'm not talking about an occasional slip-up or an occasional act of sin, but we're talking about constantly doing this, whose basic life patterns are characterized by immorality, impurities, and greed.
That's just...
But wait a minute. I prayed a prayer when I was a child. Doesn't that matter? Or when I was older. Didn't that matter? It does. If you did more than just pray a prayer. The prayer never saves you. It's what you meant on the inside of your heart. If you surrender, that's why it says that we confess him at Jesus as Lord, meaning our Master. Titus chapter 2, verses 11 through 14 tells us that the grace that saves us is also the grace that teaches us to deny our selfish, sinful natures and live a controlled life. We need something more than just our fire insurance paid up. We need something that changes us on the inside out. That's the reason why Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5, examine yourselves to see whether you're in the faith. Test yourselves. Or do you not realize that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you fail to meet the test? Is there evidence in your life that you belong to Christ? Are we sinning less frequently? A wise man named Warren Wiersbe says, a Christian is not sinless, but he does sin less. A Christian is not sinless, but he does sin less. Can that be said of you and of me? Are we growing more concerned about the things of God and how we can please Him with our life? Going back to what we talked about a few weeks ago, about walking worthy of the calling that we have on our life. So, now what? Let's close with this last section, verses 8 through 14. For at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. And try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of the things that they do in secret. But when anything is exposed by the light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Look carefully then how you walk. See, we were once in darkness. Not just in the darkness, but we were darkness. Actually, darkness. Meaning there was no light in us. There was nothing desirable in us. Meaning there was nothing about you and me that would make God want to save us. There wasn't anything in us that we deserved to be saved. But when we came to know Christ, we take on the very nature of Christ, who He Himself said He is light. Look at John chapter 8, verse 12. Again, Jesus spoke to him saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk, there he is again, in darkness, but will have the light of life. So we're no longer having to do things in the dark. We can come out and live in the light. For too long, we have let what was in the dark come out into the light and push us into the dark. How about we stop being in the dark and come out into the light where we were supposed to be all along and truly be the light? So the way for us to live as children of the light, forsaking our old nature and living the way our new nature says for us to live, is to remember we are not the same as what we were. Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, which means we're in the light, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. So that sinful nature, that impurities, the sexual immorality, the greed has passed away. Behold, I love that word, behold, because it's like, stop everything, hold the presses, look out. The new has come. God has made us new in Christ Jesus. Flip the table. Jesus is good. I like that. What does it mean to live as children of light? It's one that has lived in goodness and in truth, as we see in verse 9. What did it say in verse 9? For the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. We need to find out what pleases God. Verse 10. Try to discern what is pleasing. Verse 11. We have nothing to do with the deeds of darkness anymore. Remember the tornado warnings? Remember the sirens? Sometimes that warning came in the middle of the night. Because Jesus loves us so much, He sends us a warning, even if it's in the middle of the night and wakes us up. Think about some of these tornadoes that have come in the middle of the night. There was no warning. And you didn't hear anything, and you just slept through it. Or if you were a kid and your parents said, well, they're young, they're fine, and they go to the storm shelter, but yet you're stuck laying in the bed when the tornado hits. Do they really love you if they didn't try to protect you? But see, God loves you so much that He sent the tornado warning for you, but He also gave you the storm shelter, which is Jesus Christ. That firm foundation that we just sung about, that we can come and stand on, because He won't fail. He never fails, and He won't start now. Look at the end of verse 14. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Because we've accepted Christ, that means He lives in us. So His light is in us and should be shining out to others. But this verse says that if we would just simply wake up, His light will shine on us. And we're the spotlight. We're like the moon. The moon is completely dark. Go to the side of the moon that's facing us right now, and there's no light there. It's dark. Because the sun doesn't. The moon reflects the sun, but it has no light of its own. We, too, are the same way. We reflect whatever we're looking at. So if we're looking at something sinful, then we reflect something sinful. But if we're looking at something holy, then we reflect what is holy. But see, the problem with looking at something that is sinful, we reflect the sinfulness, but all we get in return is darkness. Because why do we do it in the dark? Why is it that we're always shameful about it? Or we try to hide it from someone knowing? Or we make up lies to get around it? Because it's in the dark.
You're ashamed of it.
Because we don't want to be caught. But see, when we're in the light, you do something great, what is it? You want to tell everybody about it. You don't want to keep that to yourself. Wouldn't it be a whole lot better if we lived our lives in the light? Because God loves us so much, He issues His warning once again. Isn't it time for us to wake up and recognize the danger of living in the darkness? Look at the rest of that. Verses 15, 21. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish and understand what the will of the Lord is. But understand what the word of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery. But be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms, in hymns, in spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Sure, it's tough to live a God-rated life in an R-rated world. It's much easier to simply give in to the selfish passions that the world says is okay. But we pay a heavy, hefty price for doing so. Because when we do things our way and when we live a sinful life, we face the wrath of God and not the inheritance to be paid with His own blood. Walk worthy of love. Walk in the light, because He is in the light. I can guarantee you the rest of our life will be so much better. And if we walk in the light of His love and in His will, I can guarantee you the next 3 weeks will be a cakewalk. Because we'll have a happy marriage. We'll have happy, healthy children. We'll have a happy workplace. God, give us the strength. Give us the desire and the will to walk worthy of You. To walk worthy of the sacrifice that You paid so that we could have freedom and light instead of darkness. May we step out of the darkness and enjoy the light of Your love. And may we be the light to those around us. In Your name we pray. Amen. All right. We only have a couple of things coming up. Looking forward to what we got. Let's see. Don't forget to leave your prayer requests on the board in the hall. We pray over them each week. And then don't forget to leave your tithes and offerings and the plate as you leave as well. We will be doing a communion next Sunday. So be looking forward to that as we come together to enjoy that special time together. Love you. Glad that you are here. Remember, you don't have to be in darkness. Reflect the sun. Because He's always shining His love for you. We'll see you next week.